Let's take a few moments to talk about some error analysis when it comes to numerical integration. And why do we even care? Why do we care how much our error is? That's actually an important question. So let's begin. Now, the reason we care about error analysis is we're thinking to ourselves, okay, we have an answer, but do we have a good answer? Now, you might say, well, what do you mean by a good answer? Suppose someone didn't know much about the value of pi. And they went out and they said, okay, we've gotten two estimates for pi. And they said, okay, what are your estimates? Well, one estimate is 12. Okay, what's your other estimate? 3.2. Now, these are both estimates. Are they wrong? Well, no, estimates are estimates. What happens is now we have to say, well, to get an idea of the quality of the estimate, says an error. So when we say 12, we say with an error of what? Well, it's 12 plus or minus 10. That's a measurement of the error. And on the other hand, we could say 3.2 plus or minus 0.1. Now, if you check, it is true that pi is within 10 of 12. It's also true that pi is within 0.1 of 3.2. Which one is the better estimate? Well, we all know the answer to this, right? It's the one that has the smaller error. So the moral here is that if we want our estimate to be a good estimate, we also have to demonstrate that our error is small, and in particular, that it's small enough that we're satisfied with what we have. So that's why we care about error analysis. We want to not just say, oh, here's a guess, but our guess is a good guess in this quantitative measurement. Okay, so that's why we care. Now, how do we proceed about it? Well, when we actually know the function, it turns out that we can go from information about how the function is changing to get information about how much our error is off. So, in particular, it says, hey, let's start with the following. We're going to start with here the trapezoid rule. And the trapezoid rule, remember, it says, look, I'm great at estimating lines. So anything that's like a line, I'm perfect. Trapezoid, mwah, beautiful. If I'm not a line, I'm going to deviate a little bit, and so I'm going to have some error. And if you think about it, well, how do we capture things which are not lines? The way we do it is we push a little bit in terms of derivatives. And so it's reasonable to say, okay, if I'm a line, then the interesting things would happen if I'm having something going on in the second derivative, because the second derivative of a line would be zero, is sort of the punchline here. So we say, look, let's look at the second derivative, and suppose it's not too large. We can bound it. And we can bound it over the part we care about. Remember, oftentimes when we talk about an integral, when we do numerical integration, we're always doing a definite integral. And so we only say, well, what's happening in the interval we care about? So from A to B. Then the error is bounded by the size of this bound, m, times this quantity b minus a cubed over 12n squared. Now, what does this tell us? Well, it tells us that, look, if our second derivative doesn't get too big, that's a very good thing for us. And the other thing that we can see, and this is good because it matches with our intuition, it says, look, as n increases, that's driving our error down. And it's driving it down not in the best way. You know, n squared does go to zero, not as fast as other things, but it does go to zero. So the greater the number of divisions, the smaller the error. So in particular, it says, look, if we need to guarantee that we're within a certain threshold, then what we can do is we can say, let's figure out what is a bound for m. We know what b minus a is. We know what 12 is. And so if we can have a bound for m, and we have these other pieces, we just have to make sure we pick n sufficiently large so that this expression is small. Because if this is small, our error is below it, our error is small, and therefore we have a good approximation. Now, let's turn to Simpson's rule. Okay, so Simpson's rule, not a big surprise. It's a little bit similar, but kind of one surprising thing to me, it's really beautiful. Because Simpson's rule is based off of parabolas. So you'd say, okay, so anything past a parabola, we're not great at. But it's a beautiful fact, Simpson's rule is actually really good at cubics. It's amazingly good at cubics. In fact, Simpson's rule is so good at cubics, if you have a cubic, you capture the area perfectly. That's how good it is. And so you really say, look, it's the fourth derivative. So you have to take four derivatives. You say, now, look at the fourth derivative. So yeah, we should make a note here. It says, Simpson's is great at cubics. All right, so anyways, as before, we say, look at the fourth derivative, and suppose we can bound it. So again, this is the bound on the fourth derivative. You have a similar expression, b minus a to the fifth, or 180, and now n to the fourth. Same philosophies, right? If we know our m, which we can find, we know b and a, and therefore we can say, look, we know all these pieces other than n, and now as n goes up, our error goes down. But the beautiful thing is, compare n to the fourth versus n squared. So if you take 10 squared, that's 100. That's not bad. If you take 10 to the fourth, that's 10,000. And again, that's driving it down much faster. So it says Simpson's rule is really a much faster approach to understanding what's going on. So in some sense, this is why we say, look, Simpson's rule is a better way to approximate. Now, there are other rules out there. If you look at, there is something called Simpson's 3/8 rule. It turns out it's essentially a similar expression. This 180, though, goes to a different number. When it comes to sample data, we can't just say, I know what's happening with the derivatives, because we don't know what the function is, so we don't know what the sample data is. But that's when we say, if we make the assumption that the function is reasonable, whatever that means, then we think that Simpson's rule should do better. And of course, you can always come up with some crazy function where, trapezoid is better than Simpson. Well, yeah, because you cooked the books and you chose things so it worked out by coincidence. But as a rule of thumb, Simpson's rule works better. All right, so the moral of the story, there are some formulas for error analysis. If you're interested in the proofs, you can go track them down. We're only going to be saying, look, we'll just take them for now as a black box. And I know that's not the thing that we usually do, but we just want to understand that there are ways to measure error. Getting a handle on error is important so that we can say, hey, I have a guess, and not just a guess, I have a good guess, and I can back up what I claim. All right, well, let's go and do some practice.